dazzled by the moving images of our grand machine as it brings to life the visions of my journey. These are stories of liberty lost, of those who took a stand, of the trials of battle, and those who liberty forgot. Now, come close. This first story was told to me by George Hughes when I traveled to Massachusetts. He was a shoemaker who joined a crowd in front of the Boston Customs House in March of 1770.
I was there at the beginning of the violence, at the massacre in Boston. What started out as a dispute over Barber's Bill turned into a riot. I was soon on the ground among them. The Redcoats came to America to subjugate us, to enforce the acts that took our liberties from us. On that day in Boston, men lost their heads. Three of our citizens were dead on the spot. Just as their lives were taken, so was our liberty. Both are fragile and easily lost.
George told me of just one of many instances that brought us to rebellion. In April of 75, at Lexington and Concord, we stood against the Redcoats, this time armed. And this time, we fired back.
Militias all over the colonies were called out in opposition to the British in Boston.
But while the British were besieged in New England, Lud Dunmore was leading the Redcoats in Virginia. He was burning property, rallying the Loyalists. Billy Flora stood against Dunmore at Great Bridge.
I was born a free man in Virginia. I fought against Lord Dunmore's Loyalists and British regulars at Great Bridge. I knew nothing of war. I found myself on picket when the British approached. I did all I could to delay them and give the others time to prepare. I made my way back to our lines. The bullets were whistling all around me. Celebrating me as a hero for them. At Great Bridge, the determination of those who could fall on both sides made it clear to me. This was not just a rebellion. This was a revolution that would change the world.
At Great Bridge, it was made clear the way to liberty was to fight. Independence was but a whisper then. It was small victories like Billy's and larger events in Boston that brought many to join our cause of liberty and independence. Attempts at reconciliation with Britain fell on deaf ears. As a result, the Continental Congress declared our independence from Great Britain on July 4th, 1776.
Summer, 1777. The British have captured New York and now set their sights on Albany. British General Burgoyne leads a force south from Canada, while British Colonel St. Leger approaches with another from the west. If the British take Albany, they will assume control of the Hudson River and cut off New England from the rest of the colonies. General Gates of the Continental Army fortifies his position just north of the town and awaits the oncoming assault. This is a battle the Americans cannot afford to lose. Burgoyne advances once again towards Freeman's Farm, beyond two recently constructed fortifications. American troops are sent by Gates to receive them, and the British retreat after a sharp engagement. The Americans pursue and take the British fortifications, forcing Burgoyne to abandon his position. Gates' Continentals pursue Burgoyne's defeated army. Their surrender is inevitable. Gates' Continentals surround Burgoyne at Saratoga and accept his surrender on October 17, 1777. This victory will encourage the French to ally with the Americans and enter the war.
Isabella remained defiant that day and chose her path with courage and conviction. But no matter what choice they made, liberty and our resolve was tried on the field of battle. Through moments of great courage and perseverance, they gave their all to secure our liberty and our independence. John Howland once told me a story of a time when all seemed lost.
I was a soldier in Washington's army. I was with him in Princeton. It was a time to try both soul and body. Many lacked the courage to stand in front. Just when all seemed lost, General Washington appeared. I saw him brave the dangers of the field, his life hanging by a single hair, as it were. A thousand deaths flying around him.
Hold him! Hold! Brave with us! And brave fellows! There are but a few of them! Hold your lines! The day will be ours! Hold your lines!
We rallied, ready to march over the ground again. I will never forget what I felt in Princeton. Washington's greatness is far beyond my description. Believe me, I thought not of myself that day.
But in the city and the country, in communities and the hall, many would remain divided on whether to remain loyal to the king.
loyal subjects, join us, the British Legion, in driving out your rebel oppressors. I am Lieutenant Colonel Bannister Tarleton of the British Army, and I will lead you in rooting out this rebellion in the Carolinas. We must push Morgan and his patriots.
It will not be long before it becomes necessary for you to seek safety by joining us. The progress of Tarleton's British and their loyalist supporters is marked by burning and devastation. I am Daniel Morgan, Brigadier General in the Continental Army. Join the militia and fight with us against British tyranny.
King, when I met Isabella Ferguson, she told me a story of a family divided by revolution.
My husband's brother was a loyalist colonel. One day, he came to our home to enlist my husband to fight for the British.
Assembling the militia to join the British troops under Cornwallis. It may be that when this quarrel is over, I shall be made a lord. How then should I feel in hearing it is said my brother was a rebel?
James,
you know we cannot talk about this.
Stay. James, I am a rebel. Glory is in the name. My brothers are rebels, and the dog Trip is a rebel too. Rebel and be free. That is my creed. We have often talked it over, and you have never justified the British coming here to make slaves of us. We who would die first.
In the presence of the British Army, I tell you,
if you go with them, you may stay with them, for I will no longer be your wife.
What will we learn from Peter's story? What questions about our revolution remain unanswered? Will his liberty be lost at the cost of our own? What about the others? What are their stories trying to tell us?
It's a 400-mile march in the dead of summer. A lot to ask of men weary from 6 years of war. However, if we leave 2,000 men here in New York to conceal our movement south, we may be able to strike before relief arrives. We march to Virginia.
My name is Joseph Plum Martin. I joined this army 5 years hence when I was just a boy of 15. Now that the French have arrived, there is hope of stealing a victory against the British.
The British will send a fleet once word of your movements reach New York. Your navy must hold the Chesapeake.
In the end, I went to the place I hoped all my questions would be answered. Where by a miracle and with help from the French, we faced Cornwallis's army in a siege side.
The French and British fleets engage in battle off the Virginia Capes. In less than 6 hours, over 400 men are killed and wounded, and several ships are severely damaged. The British ships withdraw.
Captain,
discover Cornwallis has fortified with us. Our only option is to besiege him. We dig day and night while our artillery hammers away at their defenses. One spot is as good as another as we labor in the trenches. Some with their families close by.
Have coffee for now,
let's
let it go
cold
again.
Heavens, madam, are you not afraid of the cannonballs?
No. Feather the bullet of the gallows, but not too for them to fight against dark, too. I'll give as good as anyone might.
Surrounded now by land and by sea, Cornwallis's supplies begin to run short. He casts out hundreds of slaves whom he had promised freedom in return for their labor. They are captured wandering across the battlefields and in the woods nearby. It's a sure sign of Cornwallis's growing. After 17 days of digging, we have reached an impasse. Two fortifications stand in the way of completing our siege lines, taking redoubts 9 and 10 to allow our batteries to leave range of York. It is decided that a select group of infantry will take these redoubts by storm. The French will take 9, and the Americans 10. On the signal, we silently move towards their works, muskets unloaded. We sappers and miners are furnished with axes and are charged with cutting away a passage for the troops. Cornwallis may now tremble for his fate, for nothing but his guardian angels seem capable of saving him and his whole army from captivity. We are now able to bring all of our guns to bear on York. On the 17th day of October, our guns open with a furious cannon, but fall silent as Cornwallis requests a ceasefire. After 2 days, terms are agreed upon, and the British troops surrender their arms. Cornwallis' defeat at Yorktown is a disastrous blow to the British Army, prompting the King to begin peace negotiations. Although we declared our independence 5 years earlier, it is this victory at Yorktown, Virginia, that secures the birth of our independent and free country.
I went to Yorktown. I walked among the ruins of a great battle. The scars of the trenches now long overgrown.
What brings you here? I came to see where our great revolution ended. Why else?
Ended? Sir, this is where it all began.
It was a great realization. It is here where our story begins. For a country founded on individual freedom and the consent of the governed is truly a revolutionary one. A revolution worth fighting for. One that is ours to carry on.
Learn from them to prize our liberty and respect its fragility, to remain watchful in attempts to take it, to take action when we feel it is at risk, to be mindful that our quest should be for the common good, not to take the liberty of others, to achieve our own. To fight for liberty in our time, for those who have not yet received it. And to remember that to stand for liberty is often the road less traveled, and one of great adversity. The fate of a revolution is for you to decide.
This land was made.